We start off in Merlin's flat, and Merlin, Arthur and Gwen all stare slack-jawed, totally bewildered at Leon, who stands in the threshold, and tears glisten in Gwen's eyes.
Leon, she whispers, I can't believe you're here.
Guinevere, it has been so long since I last saw your face. The two then meet in a fierce embrace, amazed and emotional. And Merlin watches Arthur watch them, knowing this must be heart-wrenching for him. But Arthur is respectful enough of the life Leon and Gwen shared together to give them a moment. But he is uncomfortable at the sight of Gwen in another man's arms. After a few moments of taking her in, Leon then pulls back to face his friends, and he beholds them for a moment, and then pulls Merlin into a hug, and then Arthur. It's been so many centuries since they are all together. I was beginning to wonder if I would ever see you again, Leon says after pulling back. Until I found Percival, and Lancelot.
Wait, Merlin says, stunned. You found...
There is much to tell. Leon, Arthur cuts in. How do you already remember us?
I thought you died during Camelot's last stand, Merlin says.
No, I never perished. When the druids let me drink from the cup of life, I became immortal, though I did not know it. After the fall of Camelot, the Lady of the Lake gave me the choice between waiting for you on Earth, or resting in a death-like sleep in Avalon. I chose to sleep, and returned to life a decade ago, along with hundreds of your subjects, so that we could begin to establish your kingdom before your return.
Subjects?
Merlin says, stunned at the whole situation.
How did you find us?
Gwen asks him.
Roughly 3 days passed. We infiltrated Mordred's fortress and dispatched of an ally of his, Lord Lot. While we were there, we overheard the Lord saying that you had returned.
I determined it was time to buy back your castle. He then glances over to Merlin. But little did I know, you already had it. Arthur then follows Leon's gaze to Merlin, and he pieces it together.
Merlin? You're Darlene Plunkett, he says. You already own the castle. Why did you not tell me?
You never asked.
So the guards...
Yeah, they guarded the castle a bit too well. Even kept me out. But that was what I paid them for.
All this time, couldn't you have just ordered them to let you pass?
Look, it's complicated having to juggle so many alter egos, alright?
But you could have saved yourself a lot of trouble. If you just...
Listen, Gwen says, cutting him off. I hate to interrupt, but Arthur... Didn't you say that Gwen is in danger?
Arthur then shakes off his conversation with Merlin.
Right. The witching hour draws near. We need to rescue him from Mordred before it's too late.
So Gwen, Leon says, surprised.
You found him?
Yeah, Merlin responds. And after one day, we lost him.
We then see a thoughtful expression overtake Leon, and Gwen notices.
What is it? She says.
If Sir Gawain is in trouble, then I believe I can offer a solution.
You have a plan? Arthur asks.
Better, Leon says with a smile on his face. I have a castle. And an army. A few moments later, we see that Merlin's round coffee table has become their new makeshift round table. Together, Arthur, Gwen, Leon and Merlin all sit around it on the floor.
It is settled then, Leon begins to say.
After Merlin contacts Mordred, we will slip out and head out for my car.
What about Morgana? Merlin says.
If we leave her unprotected, Mordred may even try to fetch her himself.
I will stay here and watch her, Gwen says, but Arthur cuts in immediately.
No, that won't be necessary. Merlin and I have it covered.
Must it be you who stays behind? Gwen says to Arthur.
I just got you back.
Sire,
Leon continues. I recommend that you come with us. Our chances are far greater with the king at our side. The last time Merlin was left with Morgana, she was almost taken. What if something were to happen? I'm certain you've seen Merlin's power by now. He can handle himself. And if anything were to go wrong, sire, Sir Gawain is the one who would suffer. Arthur then glances from Gwen and Leon to Merlin, wavering, and Merlin can't believe it as he turns to Arthur. You're leaving again. It would be best if you joined us, sire, Leon says once again. Lancelot and Percival will be eager to see you. I'm eager to see Lancelot and Percival too, Merlin says. Someone has to guard Morgana. Right. Of course. It's always me who gets left behind. Why wouldn't it be? Merlin's used to be waiting by now. This will be a walk in the park for him. Merlin's sudden distress doesn't make the decision easy. Look, Arthur says. Sir Leon, Guinevere, get everything ready and give us a moment. Leon then watches as Gwen gives Arthur a kiss on the cheek, and then she rises and heads across the room, and Leon follows. My lord, you need me, Merlin says. Let me go with you. Merlin, you're the only one I trust to protect Morgana. I'll be with Gwen and Leon and Elion as soon as we fetch him. I know, it's just, well, it's stupid, but there are these moments when I think this has all been a dream, and they only go away when I can see you, when I can prove that you're really here. I can't stand being alone anymore. I don't like it any more than you do, Merlin. Leon and Guinevere mean the world to me, but neither have a sense of humour. It's going to be hours of tedium from here on out for me. Merlin then produces a little smile, and he knows Arthur is only saying that to cheer him up. Come on, you're the one that taught me that to be a king is to serve others. My people need me now, and I will come back. You better. I will. Cross your heart. And hope to live. Yes. Gwen and Leon then come back and stand over them, all set to leave. And Gwen extends Excalibur to Arthur. We're ready, she says. Are you? Arthur says to Merlin after taking the sword. And Merlin nods. It's time. And he closes his eyes and channels his telepathic connection with Mordred. We then see Accolon and Mordred watch Merlin's flat from one of the many windows, while Morgause keeps an eye on Gawain. Moonlight pours into the tower. We agree to your proposition. After hearing this, Mordred smiles and then turns to Accolon. Emerus has agreed. Finally. But we choose the location of the trade, Merlin continues. Name it, Mordred replies after seeing no problem with that idea. Merlin then moves over to the window of his living room, and Arthur, Gwen and Leon watch him, willing the plan to work. Are you near a window? Merlin asks. Of sorts? Look out. Can you see Westminster Bridge? The others wait, waiting for Mordred to take the bait. And Mordred heads to another window on the opposite side of the tower and looks out. There is the bridge, lit up in the distance. The water around it is black with nightfall, and gold light from the city shimmering on its ripples. I see it. He's distracted, Merlin says. All right, go, go! Arthur then ushers Gwen and Leon out of the door, and with one last meaningful glance at Merlin, he then shuts the door and is gone. And at the window, Merlin anxiously watches his friends hurry out of the flat and run behind the building. But little does he know that Accolon is watching the dark shapes of Arthur, Gwen and Leon hurry out of Merlin's flat as well, though in the dark it's impossible to tell the third figure, Leon, from Merlin. He tosses a glance in Mordred's direction to make certain that he is not watching, then looks back at his enemies as they disappear around the building. Gawain, however, will not play the fool again, and he notices Accolon's intent frown out the window. Something must be up. What are you staring at? Morgause says to him. You, Gawain responds as he looks up at her.
Maybe after all this abduction business is water under the bridge, we could have a drink together. Morgos then sends a death glare at him, and Gwen looks on satisfied with his sarcastic comment. Mordred then stares out over Westminster Bridge, and continues to talk to Merlin. We will be waiting for you. And Emerus, if you do not show up by the appointed time, do not expect to see Sir Gawain again. At least, not in one piece. We then see Arthur and Gwen follow Leon behind Merlin's flat building and come off to another street, where they climb inside Leon's car and take off. Merlin stands in his flat, alone again, hoping against hope that everything will go according to plan. We then see Leon's car as it drives down the street. Eventually, it pulls up to a stop outside a classy, Victorian-style house, big like a mini manor, expansive front lawn, white balcony above the front door. All the windows are dark. It looks like no one's home. This is the house Elian and I share. He's probably still awake. How do you intend to spark his memory exactly? Arthur says. Well, Leon cuts in. With Percival and Lancelot, I noticed their memories were triggered by a key phrase or memory that held great significance for them in their past. He then quickly remembers something. On the way to the sanctuary, I shall need to clear up a few things regarding Lancelot's last few days. But first, let's take care of Elian. They then unlock the door, and it slowly creeps open. The house is pitch dark this late at night. Elian? Elian, Gwen says. Gwen? With a long robe and slippers on, a squinting Elian then appears at the top of the stairs. What's going on? I expected you to be back hours ago. Who are they? Oh. Hello, Arthur. Elian, we need to talk to you. It will all make sense in a moment. I hope. Totally confused, Elian then looks from Arthur and Leon to Gwen. Are you in some kind of trouble? No. It's all right, Elian. Gwen then approaches her brother and takes his face in her hands. She closes her eyes, thinking back to a moment that might finally trigger his memories. Her last words to him. Father would be proud of you. Elian stares for a moment, and his face slowly transitions from confused to thoughtful. He then has a flash of a memory, where he fought the enchanted floating sword to defend his sister. And just when they thought the worst was over, he collapsed, wounded, and Gwen held him in her arms for his last moments, and she whispered, Father would be proud of you. Present Elian then gazes into her eyes, and of you. Gwen then gives a beaming smile, and tears glisten in her eyes. Gwen, Elian says, starting to realise. Gwen! I can't believe you're here! He then pulls her in for an excited hug, and Gwen takes it in. Beyond Gwen's shoulder, Elian's eyes then trail to Arthur and Leon. Sire! Leon! Gwen giggles joyfully as Elian jumps into another hug with both of them. And when they pull back, Arthur and Leon clap their hands on his shoulders. It's good to have you back, Elian, Arthur says. Good to be back, sire. What happened? While I would love to tarry here, Leon cuts in, we cannot afford to delay. So Gawain's life is on the line. Wait. What? Gawain? He's in danger. We can explain it on the way, Gwen says after putting a loving hand on his arm. Leon then turns to Arthur. As soon as we reach the sanctuary, sire, you can assume control of the army I've been preparing for you. Your return will certainly put a fire in their hearts. Leon and Arthur then share a smile. Things are really falling into place now. We then go back to Merlin's flat, and we see Merlin splash water from the sink onto his face, without bothering to dry it off. He then strides into the living room. All the lights are on, candles are lit, and he paces frantically across the floor. His eyes are drooping shut. He's tired, but suddenly he slaps himself.
No! Stay awake!
Can't risk any nightmares now. Arthur is counting on you to keep watch. He then hears a muffled whimper, and he tenses up. He then hears it once again, but more desperate this time, and then a long, mournful wail. Female. Morgana's. Something is wrong. He then practically runs down the hall, and Morgana's moaning and wailing grow louder the closer he gets to the door. He can hear Galahad from inside her flat.
Mum, you're all right. It's just a dream.
Merlin then frantically raps on the door.
Shh, Galahad continues. Someone's knocking. Please be quiet.
Galahad, open the door. But there's no response, and Galahad falls silent, and Morgana's cries continue. Merlin then steps back from the door, and gets ready, and rams his shoulder against it, but it doesn't give.
Fine.
He backs up, and waves a hand over the doorknob.
Alisi duro rein.
It then unlocks, and he spills inside. Galahad then jolts, startled, surrounded by the boxes and other clutter left over from the move. Morgana lies on the mattress whimpering, in the middle of the floor, blankets twisted around her legs, and Galahad sits beside her, trying to hold her down, and he stares at Merlin with wide eyes.
You shouldn't be in here. I can help her. I'm handling it. Just stay back.
Merlin then goes to the mattress, and Galahad jumps up and shuts the door before anyone else hears the commotion.
Morgana!
Beneath Morgana's fluttering eyelids, he can see a glimpse of flash of gold. The boxes around them begin to levitate off the floor, and Galahad snatches one from the air, and it contains a small television set.
Ha! Finally found the telly!
While Galahad is distracted, Merlin discreetly uses his own magic to counteract Morgana's, and gently sets the boxes down. He then lowers himself to his knees by the mattress.
Morgana!
Morgana! He puts a hand on her, and Morgana then bolts upright, screaming her head off.
Whoa! Hey! Morgana!
Wide eyes, panting, Morgana then registers Merlin's face in the dark.
You! What are you doing here?
He heard you screaming from the hall and broke in. Merlin then glares at Galahad, and then Morgana looks between the two of them, and she shivers after the fright of her nightmare.
Are you alright?
Merlin says. But Morgana gives an unconvincing nod. She's shaking, self-conscious, trying to hide her fear, when she is clearly traumatized from whatever terrors assailed her in her dreams. Something in Merlin's face then changes. It softens with pity. Arthur has been there to help him with his nightmares. But Morgana has no one. After a moment, he stoops down and folds his arms around her in an awkward hug.
It's all right, he says. It was just a dream. You're safe here.
Galahad nears quietly from behind, just watching them. As Morgana begins to calm down, Merlin then lets her go.
Here, I'll just make you some tea.
He then gets up and heads into the kitchen, while Morgana tries to pull herself together. Galahad then appears beside Merlin, handing him the kettle.
Thanks, Gally.
Galahad then salutes him in response and returns to the living room as Morgana comes into the kitchen, still shaken.
I'm sorry for waking you. There's no bother. I never sleep.
What were you dreaming about? Morgana doesn't want to answer. She feels ashamed. Sometimes it helps to talk. Morgana then pauses for a few seconds, and eventually responds.
A woman. She took Galahad away from me.
Gally's father was somehow involved, and then there was just this darkness. I can't describe it. I think it's supposed to mean something. It feels like something is coming. Something dreadful.
Merlin then frowns in concern. Morgana's nightmares have never been a small matter.
How can that be?
I don't know.
We then see Leon's car pull to a stop alongside the road, and he looks out the window and starts to speak. "The castle given to me by the inhabitants of Avalon is protected by powerful magic, and tucked deep in the forest where it cannot be found. There is no road to take us there, so we will continue on foot." We then see vibrant bluebells carpet the floor of the forest as though they were grass, and there is a heavenly air about the place, almost magical. Leon and Elian walk on ahead, while Arthur and Gwen take their time, holding hands. "I thought I would never see you again," Arthur says. "I knew you would return one day. I just had no idea when. I'm so sorry I left you, Guinevere." And after Leon explained that you and Lancelot were under Morgana's spell that night when you kissed, "I'm truly sorry for how I treated you. You are not to blame. That evil was Morgana's alone. All that matters is that you're here now. With me." Loving smiles are then exchanged, and Arthur looks ahead just in time to catch Leon looking back, and when Leon realizes Arthur is noticed, he faces forward, and Arthur's smile fades. It's just another reminder that Gwen's marriage to Leon will need to be addressed. We then head back to Elizabeth Tower, and Mordred roughly unchains Gwen from the rail and lets him fall onto his hands and knees, and Gwen gasps and groans. It will take a few minutes for the blood to flow back to his arms. Morgoth then seizes Gwen by the foot, and she snaps a ball and chain around his ankle. "Oh," Gwen begins to say, "now that's a bit archaic. Don't you think someone will notice if I'm trudging around London with this hanging off my foot?" "Be human, Haydan," Morgoth says, and a magic ripple pulses through the ball and chain, and it begins to fade, until it eventually turns invisible. "You will not be trudging anywhere, Sir Gawain," Morgoth says, "not without us." "Clever spell, Morgoth," Mordred then cuts in. "If only you had been clever enough not to fail in securing Morgana yesterday. Morgana would be safe with us if it were not for Emerus." At the window, we then see Accolon's eyes shift from the direction of Merlin's flat to Mordred and Morgoth, calculating. Should he risk it? After a moment, he then steps forward. "I have just received a message from Lady Elaine. My presence is needed without delay at Crystallum Castle." Mordred and Morgoth then look up. "Do you think she is growing suspicious?" Mordred asks. "She may be. But worry not, I will smooth things over and return before the witching hour arrives." With a nod, Mordred then smiles at Accolon, who starts to exit. But as he passes Gwen, their eyes lock, and the way Accolon looks at him, Gwen knows without a doubt that he's planning something behind his allies' backs. We then return to the forest, and it's breezy and there's silver moonlight on everything in sight. Leon, Arthur, Gwen and Elian then come upon a towering portcullis of ancient cream-coloured stone, flanked on either side by dense trees. Wind ripples through its red flags, which bear the golden Pendragon crest. Two guards are stationed there, and when they see the company approaching, they stiffen to attention. "My Lord Leon," one of the guards says, "did you finally get the castle back?" "No." "But," Leon says with a proud smile, "I got the king." The guard then looks past Leon to Arthur, and his eyes expand in wonder, and then he turns to the other guards. "The king has returned! Bid him entrance! Move! Quickly, now!" The guards scramble from their positions to raise the portcullis, and within a few beats, it groans and rises up. And Leon steps aside to let the once and future king lead the way, and Arthur passes through the gate, followed by Gwen, Leon and Elian. We then go to Morgana's flat, and we see Galahad sleeping on the mattress, or at least, pretending to be. He opens one eye watching, and we then see Morgana sitting on the sofa, and Merlin bringing her a cup of tea. "Thanks," Melina mutely acknowledges her. You can go now. I'll be fine. What about your dreams? Don't you think they might not be safe for Galahad? What do you mean? You made the boxes float in your sleep, Morgana.
I saw. I'm surprised you haven't already called the police on me.
Well, I guess you understand what the psychiatrist is for then. When Galahad started telling his classmates that I nearly burned my bedroom down in my sleep. Do you think the teachers let that one go?
Merlin doesn't know what to say. He's never known what to say when she gets like this.
You know, I wouldn't feel too bad about it. I have a lot of trouble with nightmares. Do you make furniture float around the room like some kind of escaped science experiment?
Merlin opens his mouth to respond, but stops himself.
He can't reveal his secret.
I thought not.
Why do you think we had to move in the first place? It's impossible to stay in one place for long with my... whatever you call it. Truth be told, we probably can't stay here very long either.
I can't afford it.
We're only here now because I worked out a deal with the landlady. Soon we'll be up and running again. I'm sure. And I'm sure whatever nightmares you might have are nothing compared to mine. There's no one like me.
Merlin then takes a seat beside her. Most people think they're going through something that's entirely unique to them. Everyone thinks they're the exception. But there's always someone out there who's been there and made it to the other side.
Morgana then takes this in. If you need to go back to sleep, you can. I'll stay here and watch. I couldn't ask that of you.
I know. That's why I'm offering.
Are you sure?
I'll be awake either way.
Thank you.
Merlin shrugs, and from the mattress, Galahad watches him with his one open eye. He then closes it with a smile.
We then go back to the new castle, and we see that it's situated in the middle of a lush emerald green field that's bordered by wild forest land. Elegant arches and climbing towers. It's lit by torches, and it glitters in a golden haze against the dark of the night. It looks like something out of a majestic painting. Arthur, Leon, Gwen and Elian then enter the magnificent sanctuary's great hall. It's massive. An absolute monument compared to Camelot's Great Hall. Vaulted ceilings reach halfway to heaven, and banners bearing the Pendragon crest hang from the walls, which are lined with mounted torches. Enormous windows spill moonlight into the hall, and the walls and ceilings are dominated by breathtaking paintings. There is an aura of the supernatural about the castle, as if magic flows through it, in every paint stroke and stone. It feels like they have been transported back to 6th century Camelot. And the subjects all dress in vivid clothing with medieval influence. Even the servants have more refined attire. While Arthur, Gwen and Elian marvel at their surroundings as Leon leads them, palace subjects stop and marvel at the free people that Leon has brought with him. And they recognize their king from their former lives and whisper excitedly.
Is that who I think it is?
It's King Arthur! He's back!
Gwen, Elian and Arthur smile at the subjects as they pass, and Leon surges with pride for his king. Soon, a crowd of assorted subjects, soldiers and servants has begun to follow, but there are no children and no elderly. None of those who have returned to life from Camelot are past their 30s.
Sire! Guinevere!
We then see Sir Lancelot, clad in mail and armour, breaks away from the gathering crowd. He stares ahead at Arthur and the others, and beside him, Percival then emerges from the crowd, and both are alive, and both are ecstatic to see their friends, and they hurry toward them.
Lancelot! Percival!
Arthur says, overjoyed, and the two of them are then met with warm embraces from each of their friends. It's a dream come true for all of them. And there is so much joy and laughter, and they are beside themselves with happiness.
Where did they dig you out of?
Percival says to Elian, laughing. We've been searching for you for years.
Would you believe I was a psychiatrist, of all things?
No, Lancelot cuts in. Not in 1500 years.
What about the two of you? Arthur asks.
I was in Scotland Yard, Lancelot replies.
And Percival? What were you?
Trust me. You don't want to know.
Lancelot then pauses when he reaches Gwen, and the awkwardness from their final interaction remains, and he resorts to offering a deep bow.
My queen, he says.
Sir Lancelot?
Arthur and Elin then clap Lancelot and Percival on the back, and Leon stands by, just bursting with pride, reveling in everyone's elation.
It's good to see you, Lancelot, Arthur says once more.
Sire, I must explain myself. Explain my actions during my last...
Leon told us. I know now that you were both under Morgana's influence. I am so sorry for what happened. If I had only known...
You have nothing to apologize for, sire.
We then see Percival glancing about, excited.
Where's Merlin? Have you found him yet?
He had to stay behind, Gwen replies. There is so much to tell you.
Well, sire, Leon says to Arthur.
The people are congregating. They will expect a word.
Arthur then looks to his friends, who nod, and he leaves them and makes his way towards the raised platform at the centre of the Great Hall. As he then goes, a servant drapes a regal cloak over his shoulders, which covers his modern attire. Soon, every subject, servant and soldier from Camelot is gathered before Arthur, and they all stare at their king in awe, in jubilation, while the air fills with cries and shouts of joy. The roar of the crowd is jarring, and everyone is ecstatic to have him back at last, and Arthur stands there, with tears welling up in his eyes, and he sees his people before him, overwhelmed with happiness at his return. It's as wonderful a welcome home as any man could ask for. As he takes it all in, we see Arthur's smile fade. Out of all the kings of history, that he should be named the once and future. Arthur is overwhelmed by guilt and gratitude. Gradually, the clamour of the crowd begins to fade in order to give him a chance to speak, but Arthur is much too overcome. Emotion constricts his throat, and Gwen and Leon exchange glances.
Why is he so silent?
And then, to the amazement of all, Arthur bends down and kneels before his people, with his head bowed. There are murmurs of confusion throughout the crowd, as none of them know what their king is doing.
Thank you, he begins to say,
for waiting for me, for everything. I don't know why I have been given this second chance, but I swear to you, I will not waste it as I did last time. I know I have committed many wrongs, slaughtered people for their beliefs, and I'm so sorry.
We then see the crowd is in awe of Arthur's humility. But I promise, Arthur then says as he looks up,
I will break. I will end the cycle of persecution started by my father. Never again will anyone have to live in fear for what they believe. I understand now that to be a king is to be a servant of the people, and though I am destined to rule, I am called to serve, and that is an honor I will never deserve. I ask only that you remember that I am but a servant in a king's robe. Stunned silence overcomes the halls.
Long live the king!
Leon calls out, and the entire hall takes up the call, and they repeat it over and over again. Leon, Gwen, Lancelot, Percival and Elian applaud with the rest of the crowd, sending glowing smiles at Arthur. And Arthur stays there on his knees, basking in his reunion with his people, and gazing out at them. And he smiles.
We then go to Acalon, who slinks down the street. He spares a cautious glance over his shoulder as he makes his way toward Merlin's flat. As we then go to Morgana's flat, we see that she has fallen asleep on the sofa, and Merlin sits in silence, observing her. He heaves a quiet sigh. He feels so much guilt, regret, and unease churning within him. Without the immediate threat of her harming Arthur, it's easier for Merlin to see her clearly. Just a person, trying to make her way in life. She's a lot less intimidating like this.
Can't sleep either.
Merlin then glances up, and Galahad stands before him. After a moment, he takes a seat beside him on the sofa, careful not to wake his mother.
Why do you think Arthur is a king? Merlin asks him.
I don't think it.
I know it.
It's like how there are some things you just know without needing to be told. Like knowing you're alive. You just do. I'm not really supposed to talk about it.
You're telling me now?
Yeah, I know. It's just, Mum says we don't need anyone but each other. But then you just end up lonely.
Galahad looks up, surprised, as though Merlin just read his mind.
We're social creatures, human beings, Merlin begins to say. We need to be talked to be recognized, to be understood, or at least just heard out. Otherwise, how can we judge whether we're sane if we don't have a reference point?
Galahad watches him with abandon, hanging on every word.
He needed this, to be understood, like Merlin said.
There's nothing wrong with that, Merlin continues. It doesn't make you needy to need someone.
We're not equipped to handle isolation, because we're not meant to be alone.
I know. Believe me, I think everyone should get the chance to live surrounded by people who love them. Or, if life surprises you, as it often does, to die, surrounded by people who love them.
Merlin then looks at Galahad. He's wise beyond his years.
Yes.
They then hold each other's gazes. They then hear a soft clinking sound, and both of their heads snap towards the door. And they can see that someone is fiddling with the lock. The fiddling continues until the door opens, and Acalon's silhouette fills the threshold, tall and imposing. He enters the dark room and stops. We then see that Merlin and Galahad have disappeared, hidden somewhere, and Morgana still lies there fast asleep. Confident that they are alone, Acalon looms over the sofa. He brushes a lock of Morgana's hair back, and beholds her peaceful face. Behind the door, Merlin and Galahad are concealed in the shadows, and seeing Acalon so close to Morgana, Galahad moves. He tries to come out and defend her, but Merlin holds him in place.
Stars hide your fires, Acalon begins to say. Let not light see my black and deep desires.
After observing her for a moment longer, Acalon unsheaths a deadly iridescent dagger, and he raises it poised to drive it into her heart. But Merlin then steps out from behind the door, behind Acalon.
Why don't you use magic? He says.
It'll be a lot quicker. And cleaner. Acalon tenses up, unmoving for a moment. But then he suddenly wheels around and blindly stabs at Merlin. But in a very Arthur-like fashion, Merlin seizes Acalon's wrist without any effort, and twists it behind the man's back, hardly making any noise.
Step into my office,
Merlin says as he then marches Acalon to the door, still pinning his arm behind his back. Acalon then locks eyes with Galahad, who glares back, and Acalon fixes him with a chilling stare, until Merlin has forced him out into the corridor,
and he shuts the door without a sound.
Morgana has no friends, Merlin says to him, and I happen to be her only real enemy. So you, no doubt, have come from Mordred. I knew I sensed the presence of another powerful sorcerer. I just thought it was Morgana. But what baffles me, taking the dagger, Merlin then releases Accolon and surveys his enemy, intrigued, is why would an ally of Mordred want to kill Morgana? Now where is the sense in that? We then see that Accolon looks more shaken than we've ever seen him.
You are Emerus, he says in a nervous tone.
I had hoped I would run into you. I have been searching everywhere.
Well, here I am.
And you are? To Merlin's confusion, Accolon then kneels, low and reverent.
I am Urien, your humble servant.
My humble servant wouldn't have tried to stab me.
Forgive me. I did not know who you were. I have been a false follower of Mordred for 4 years, and all the while searching for you to offer you my help in the war against him. When I learned about Morgana's whereabouts, I fought to end her life before she could end yours.
Merlin studies him.
Who is this slippery stranger? Is he telling the truth or not?
Slowly, he extends a hand to help Accolon up, and Accolon accepts his hand, but then whips out a second knife, plainer than the first, and yanks Merlin forward into the blade, and it pierces him right in the gut. Merlin gasps. He staggers, his hand flying to the knife. Too stunned to breathe, he hunches forward like he's about to drop to his knees. After a moment, he then yanks the blade out, and eyes flashing gold. There's then no blood on his shirt, and Accolon blanches. Merlin then looks from the knife in his hand to Accolon.
False follower of Mordred. Are you sure about that?
Terrified, Accolon then spins around and flies across the landing and tears down the stairs, leaping over the rail halfway down to escape faster, and Merlin watches after him, satisfied that his might causes men to flee in terror. He then returns to Morgana's flat. Inside, Galahad has awakened Morgana, who is groggy from sleep.
Gally, slow down. What are you talking about?
Morgana, a man tried to break in here a moment ago.
What?
What happened? She then turns to Galahad. Are you alright?
I'm fine.
I scared him off, but I don't think you two are safe here. He might come back.
Wait, but did he take anything? I don't own anything worth stealing.
No, he didn't. But I think it would be best if we switch over to my flat for safety.
Should we call the police? Galahad says.
Later. Right now I think we should head to my flat. At least, until morning.
Alright,
Morgana says, and she rises and retrieves her coat. Galahad takes his sweet time gathering up each of his toy soldiers from the mattress, until Merlin comes over and scoops up the rest of them. The three of them then exit into the hall, and head down to Merlin's flat and slip inside. Merlin spares a brief, cautious look around the hall, before he closes the door behind them.
We then go back to the sanctuary, and in a small, intimate castle chamber, Arthur, Leon, Gwen, Elion, Lancelot and Percival have been fitted with attire of a more familiar, medieval-inspired nature. They stand around a table that is laden with maps.
If Mordred has taken Gwen to Westminster Bridge, Arthur begins to say, then they will be completely out in the open.
Mordred must be prepared to defend himself if he thinks Merlin is coming, Lancelot cuts in.
Merlin is more powerful than any sorcerer I've ever seen.
And Mordred knows it, Percival says.
He must not think he is in any danger.
Gwen then speaks up.
He must be aware that any public use of magic on either side would not be well received by any bystanders.
He might send for the authorities. and I'm sure Mordred believes that as long as he has Gawain, he's safe.
We will have to distract Mordred long enough to get to Gawain, Leon says.
How? Elion asks.
That won't work.
Mordred would recognize us.
Perhaps there is our advantage.
They then all look to Arthur.
No one would distract Mordred more than me.
The table falls silent while they consider this.
Merlin wouldn't like that, Lancelot says.
Merlin isn't here.
We then go to Westminster Bridge, and it's the dead of night. Mordred and Morgoth stand on the bridge with Gawain waiting. One or two civilians walk by, and some cars pass, and Big Ben chimes 3 o'clock from across the water.
It is 3 in the morning, Morgoth says.
They should be here by now.
Patience, Mordred replies.
Sir Mordred, Lady Morgoth.
Mordred then spins around, and he stops dead at the sight of Arthur striding towards him, dressed in modern attire with a long black overcoat.
There he is, his great enemy, persecutor of his kind, the man who sentenced the woman he loved to death.
And Mordred puts on a calm front to mask his swirling emotions.
Arthur, he says, I nearly thought you were not going to show.
I would never abandon a friend.
Is that so? Could have fooled me.
Yeah, me too, Gawain shouts out.
It's about time.
Where is Morgana?
Morgoth exclaims.
Hurry up and make the exchange.
Quiet, Morgoth. I will handle this.
Mordred then steps away from Gawain to greet Arthur, and his eyes wander about.
Have you brought the Lady Morgana?
Mordred, I think we can both agree that we have no desire to make a scene.
Agreed.
Gawain then tries to move, but the magic ball and chain has him pinned exactly where he is.
Why don't we take a walk? Arthur says to Mordred.
And Mordred eyes him, and eventually gives a nod, and the pair falls into step beside one another, and begin to stroll slowly down the bridge alongside the water.
Casual, as though two friends might, as though they hadn't run each other through during their last interaction.
As Mordred then watches Arthur from the corner of his eye, he notices that he has hidden Excalibur beneath his overcoat.
Whatever happened to not wanting to make a scene?
My preferences may prove to conflict with necessity.
Mordred then begins to scan his surroundings.
Where is Emerus?
Enjoying a few rounds on the London Eye?
I have come independent of Merlin. He would never allow that.
I don't take orders from Merlin.
No.
But you do bend them for him.
Interesting how the moment you learned a favourite friend was a sorcerer,
your view of magic shifted from aversion to acceptance.
I never meant to bring you any harm, Mordred.
If I had the chance to undo my errors, perhaps things would be different.
I will never retract my offer of peace.
I am no longer interested in your talk of peace.
Where is Morgana?
Not here.
You have failed to bring her.
You can't fail at something you were never trying to do.
You think yourself clever, do you?
No matter. Due to your lack of cooperation, Sir Gawain will lose his life once more.
Tell me. How do you hope to accomplish murder in such a public place?
Mordred then draws a blank.
Your youth shows, Mordred.
You have not planned as carefully as you thought.
I would like to propose a new arrangement.
You will release Sir Gawain to me now, or Merlin will kill Morgana.
You said Emerus was not here.
He's not.
He's with Morgana.
And if you don't comply with my terms, he will take her life.
And you will lose your most valued ally.
You're bluffing.
If Gawain is any indication, then Morgana would not have her memories either.
You would not kill her.
No,
I wouldn't.
But Merlin would.
He's done it before. And do you really think he cares more for Morgana than me and Gwaine? Mordred's rage then boils beneath his attempts to remain calm. So what will it be, Mordred? The choice is yours. And you can have a go at me now if you like. But my knights will not let you do that easily. Take a look around you. Mordred then heeds his surroundings. He notices Leon and Percival disguised as civilians across the way, swords hidden beneath their layers of clothing, just like Arthur. And then he sees a small boat near the bridge with the word police written on the side, and Lancelot and Elion are aboard, and they have two crossbows at the ready, mostly obscured beneath their jackets they've draped over the weapons. Why was I not told they'd all returned? Mordred says to himself. If you kill me, they'll come after you. But worse than that, you'll have Merlin to answer to. And I don't think you killing me again would put him in a good mood. It's all falling apart for Mordred. He wants nothing more than to run Arthur through on the spot and be done with it. But Arthur or the knights would surely kill him in turn. And Mordred has no desire to die today. Furious, Mordred marches away from Arthur and back toward Morgause and Gwaine. And Arthur follows, quietly triumphant. He knows he's won. Morgause! Mordred calls out. Release the knight! Where is Morgana? With Merlin. And if we do not release Gwaine, he will kill her. But we need him to ensure that we receive Morgana. Would you rather your sister die? Release him! A reluctant Morgause then releases the enchantment over the ball and chain attached to Gwaine's foot, and it materializes into view, and then unlocks, and Arthur takes a weary Gwaine by the arm. Pleasure doing business with you, Arthur says. We should do this again sometime. Yeah, Gwaine cuts in. Just maybe take less time next time. The two then walk away. Arthur! Mordred calls out. I will kill you before this ends. On Kara's grave. I swear it. Arthur and Gwaine then leave their infuriated enemies behind them. We then go back to the sanctuary, and it's dawn finally, and the morning light permeates through the castle. Arthur, Gwaine, Percival, Leon, Elion and Lancelot all enter the sanctuary, and the knights flock around Gwaine, patting him on the back, rejoicing in his return. Gwen then makes her way to Arthur and greets him with a kiss that he returns, until he notices that Leon is watching them and breaks away, resorting to hugging her instead. How uncomfortable the whole situation is. We then see all of them gathered around the table, and Gwaine begins to speak. One thing is for certain, there is friction between them. They're always at each other's throats. Morgause is the most rebellious. She's obsessed with getting Morgana back. And Mordred, he didn't even know whether Arthur had an army yet. Whoever he's working for, they're not telling him anything. Over time, Lancelot replies, we have gathered some information about his allies. They are led by the daughter of Vivian and Gorlos, the twin sister of Morgause. We believe Gaius smuggled her out of Camelot during the Great Purge and handed her over to the Dizir. And she has an army. Thousands. Many of them were originally from a cult that awaited Mordred's return, but now we believe they're all in over their heads. They serve out of the fear of the Lord Sorcery. Yeah, Gwaine says. I met one of those lords. That Acolon. He gets his way most frequently. Seems to have his own agenda. A first-class manipulator. Even had me fooled for a moment there. Don't hold it against yourself, Gwaine, Arthur says. If you hadn't told him about Morgana, they would have killed you. In the end, it saved your life. Percival claps a hand on Gwaine's shoulder. And it's a good job it did. And I'm sure that all that Gwaine's picked up will prove useful, Elion says. Probably annoyed the hell out of them too, Percival adds. I made it my aim in life. Well, Arthur says, the rescue mission was successful.
We now have the last of our brothers safe with us once more. If my presence will not be missed, I must return to London City and see that all is well with Merlin. He then begins to start for the door.
It's a relief to have you back safe and sound, Lancelot says to Gawain, and that Morgana has not fallen into enemy hands.
Speaking of Morgana, Percival says, she will have to be dealt with. We then see that Arthur's steps slow to a stop as he listens to their conversation.
Percival is right, Lancelot begins to say. Now that we know how valuable Morgana is to our adversaries, perhaps we should consider removing her from the equation.
I couldn't agree more, Gawain says.
What do you suggest? Elian asks.
We kill her before she kills us, Percival exclaims. And Arthur hears him. Hold on, he says. This is getting out of hand.
We see that Leon watches in silence, not wanting to challenge Arthur's orders.
Justice must be served, Lancelot says. We will avenge each other.
I suppose you're right, Gwen cuts in. She is far too deadly to be allowed to roam about.
Right now, she is vulnerable. We may not get another chance.
What? No!
Out of the question!
Arthur, we understand your hesitance to kill Morgana, but after everything she's done, everything that I know she will continue to do as soon as she remembers...
Morgana is a danger to your mission, Arthur, Lancelot continues. A menace to your destiny. She will try to undermine your path to the throne.
Morgana has no recollection of the past.
Who is to say she ever will?
It didn't take much for me, Gawain says.
Or me. Or me. Me either. Nor I.
I don't care! No one is to harm Morgana or her son.
There is then dead silence, and shock from Leon and all the knights.
Her son, Leon says in disbelief. How did she ever find love? Percival murmurs.
Now if that will be all, I must get back.
Before Merlin's heart fails. It's clear the knights and Gwen do not approve of this decision, and it is evident that the conversation will come up again. But still, Gwen follows Arthur out of the room, and we see Leon stare longingly after her.
As we then go back to Crystallum Castle, we see crystal chandeliers scatter little rainbows down over the small gathering, as we see an irritated Elaine reprimanding Accolon, Mordred and Morgos.
And you saw it fit to go behind my back to extract this information, she says.
We had everything under control, Mordred replies.
Clearly not! Otherwise Morgana would be here. And if not Morgana, then at least a dead knight. But you cannot even kill a man already within your grasp. This is absurd.
Sister, we nearly had them, but the king managed to outwit Mordred.
Mordred then glares at Morgos.
I was not the only one who was outwitted.
Enough! Elaine exclaims. You're all dismissed.
You forget, Lady Elaine, Mordred replies in a cold tone, that I do not answer to you.
Mordred then spins on his heel and stalks off, and Morgos follows shortly. After a moment, we see Accolon, always eager to appease every side.
I still answer to you, my lady.
Elaine is exasperated with Mordred and Morgos, and she looks at Accolon like he's her last hope.
Thank you, my lord Accolon. I would expect this kind of insubordination from Mordred, even after all we've done for him for these past 4 years.
But Morgos knows what is at stake, and she still defies me.
I did all I could to dissuade them, but they refused.
It will not happen again, my lady.
This I promise.
With a bow, Accolon then turns, with his back to Elaine, and he gives a subtle smirk as he walks away.
We then go to London City, in the middle of a busy street. It's morning and we see cars flashing past,
and Arthur and Gwen stand on the edge of the street where Gwen inaudibly demonstrates to Arthur how to hail a cab. We then see a cab slow to a stop before them, and they enter. The pair then sit together in the back seat, and Arthur gazes ahead at nothing in particular, pensive.
"You seem distant, Arthur," Gwen says to him. "Is something on your mind?"
"How soon after my death did you marry Leon?" We then see the driver of the cab, who coincidentally was the driver who drove Merlin and Arthur, and after hearing yet another bizarre conversation, he squints at them in the rearview mirror. Why does he always get the weirdos?
"About 3 years," Gwen replies to Arthur. "It was the most difficult decision I've ever been forced to make. Merlin insisted that I wait for you, but I had no idea when you were coming back. I had to think of the kingdom."
"You did the right thing. You put the people first. I could not have chosen a better queen." Gwen then perceives that something more is behind his mood.
"Don't think you can leave it off like that. I can always tell when something is bothering you.
Now that we are united again, where does that put Leon?"
"Leon and I had our day, and we grew to love one another in our own way, but it's been years for him. I am sure he no longer expects anything. Our marriage was a political agreement in the first place. As long as you are confident that Leon knows this,
I'm certain.
You've no reason to fear. There are no barriers that can keep us apart now."
She kisses Arthur on the cheek and then faces ahead. But Arthur won't let her go at that, and he turns her face and kisses her full on the lips, as the cab continues to go down the street.
We then return to Merlin's flat, and the door opens, and a weary Merlin and Morgana come in, and he closes the door behind them.
"Thank goodness," Merlin says. "I thought they'd never leave."
"They'd have left faster if you'd woken me up so that we could call the police sooner. You needed sleep after last night."
"Still."
"Where's Gally?" "He's playing on your bed with his knights. I'm going to see if you manage to get the stains out of my dress. I've got another interview in the morning."
She then heads off down the hall, and Merlin once again starts to straighten up the living room.
"Knock, knock."
Merlin tenses up. He recognizes that voice. It's Accolon.
"Is this a bad time?"
"You tried to break in last night."
"No, I actually did break in last night.
Done catching your breath after you ran away in fear?"
"Where has the strumpet gone off to? Getting dolled up for her reunion with Mordred?"
"What are you talking about?"
"Look, I'm going to make this quick. We have Arthur."
Merlin freezes, and his eyes grow in fright.
"That's impossible," he says out loud.
"We've already butchered his precious Guinevere trying to get information out of him. So Gwen too. But Arthur's really making quite a fuss over it. You should hear him blubbering. It's pitiful."
Merlin's mouth parts in horror, and tears start to spring in his eyes.
"It can't be. His beloved friends."
"No," Merlin says once again out loud.
"Unless you want your king to share their fate, you will tell Morgana and the pup to step outside. Now."
There is no question. He can't let them kill Arthur. He glances towards the hall and heads towards his bedroom at the end of it, and he sees Galahad sitting on his bed playing with his toy knights. So innocent. So oblivious to the danger.
"Hurry, will you?" Accolon continues. "I'm pressed for time."
Merlin then lifts a hand for a spell to knock the child out, and he's shaking, absolutely dying inside. Can he really do it? Be the cause of the suffering and death for this little family he's bonded with over the last few days? It's tearing him apart.
Galahad then glances up and sights Merlin through the crack in the door.
and Merlin hides his hand behind his back and plasters on a smile. Unsuspecting, Galahad smiles back, before returning to his toys. And Merlin stands in the hall, breathing heavily. But then he pauses. "You're lying."
"Am I?"
"If you really had killed Gwen and Gwaine, if you really had Arthur in your grasp, it would be Mordred who caught to gloat, not you. He's been waiting for this moment for years. There's no way in hell he'd let you steal his glory."
"He is busy gloating over Arthur as it is."
"No," Merlin says, cutting him off, now sure of himself. "You're lying. You can't be in the same place as Mordred. How would you know that Morgana left the room?"
There's then silence. He now knows that Accolon is for sure lying, and he heads back to the living room and scans outside the window. And on the pavement below, a shadowy figure stares back at him. It's Accolon.
"Do not try to lie to me," Merlin says. "I know more about lying than anyone. And if you want Morgana and Galahad, then come inside and face me."
They both then pause, and Accolon sends a cold and bitter glare his way. But he will not fight him, and with a swish of his overcoat, he turns slowly and walks away. And Merlin stares out after him for a few moments, still shaken by it all.
"Look!"
Merlin then whips around, and he sees a proud Morgana entering wearing her little dress from the previous two nights.
"Not a single stain! You saved it!"
Merlin forces a smile, and he casts another nervous glance out of the window. No Accolon. But then he glances up at the clock, and there's still no Arthur or Gwaine. They both then just stand there in silence for a few moments. It never stops being awkward between them after all the history.
"Do you have anything to drink?" Morgana asks.
Yeah. Shaking it off, Merlin leads Morgana into the kitchen, and he begins to fill up a cup of water for her, but Morgana helps herself to a bottle of wine from one of the cupboards.
"Ah, it's not really the right occasion to break into that."
"What year did you get this? It looks ancient. Where'd you get it?"
"Sir Arthur Conan Doyle,
God rest his soul." Morgana then smirks, and she takes down a pair of wine glasses.
"You think I'm kidding?"
She then pours and hands him a glass.
"Oh, no, I don't want any."
But Morgana has already filled the second glass, and hands it to him.
"A toast.
To?
Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, of course."
"Ah, God rest his soul." They then clink glasses and drink, and Merlin forces a tiny smile to disguise his ongoing discomfort.
"This is really good," Morgana says.
"Well, he was very rich." He's then surprised when Morgana laughs. It's been so long since he heard that. Well, without the maniacal edge.
We then head back to Crystallum Castle, in Elaine's chambers, and we see Elaine rise from her solid crystal table in defeat.
"It is useless," Elaine says to Morgause, who stands behind her. "The magic you've lent me is not potent enough. The day I am released from the spell and free to use my own magic again cannot come swiftly enough."
"The magic that I have shared with you," Morgause replies, "is not to blame for the crystal's failure to show anything of use."
"Well, there must be some explanation as to why they show nothing but the same darkness.
Let me try again." Taking her seat, Morgause presses her hand against the table's smooth, cool surface and stares into it. And as she begins to exercise magic, the entire tabletop turns black for her too.
"Why is this happening?" Morgause whispers. And the lights in Elaine's chambers then flicker, but Elaine and Morgause don't notice. As we then go back to Merlin's flat, we see Merlin and Morgana continue to drink the wine.
I haven't had wine this good since I was with Galahad's father, Morgana says, and suddenly her mood darkens. She's reminded herself of a past filled with suffering that she tries so hard to bury. He's lucky he left me. That way he doesn't have to deal with me. Why would you say that? Because I'm crazy. She then tries to smile at her own expense. I've tried to escape that fact for years. I'm sure he knew it. How could he not? You already know I hear voices. Her plight really tugs on Merlin's heartstrings. All these years he struggled with his own fears of losing his sanity. And here she is, just a woman trying to make sense of things that are so beyond her. So similar to how she was before everything went wrong. These voices, Merlin says, do they belong to anyone you know? Some are strangers, people I've never met, who probably don't exist. One's a woman who claims to be my sister. In the past few years, I started hearing Galahad's father. Merlin takes this in. I know. I'm insane. You've seen it firsthand now. Gally's father really dodged a bullet leaving me. I'm sorry, I shouldn't be talking like this. I don't know what I'm saying. I'm sorry. She then turns away and tries to get a handle on her emotions. And Merlin's eyes are filled with pity. He opens his mouth to speak, but closes it, stopping himself. What can he say? Gaius always warned him against helping Morgana. Better to leave her in the dark where it's safer. After all, there's nothing really he can do. Well, actually there is. No, Morgana. He then takes her by the shoulder and turns her around. Look, I know you felt alone and afraid, and I've been no help at all. I know you've felt like this longer than you can even remember. If somewhere, along your troubled way, someone had reached out and said to you, you're worth the risk, then things might have turned out different. I may have been too afraid to act before, but we've been getting a lot of second chances lately, and hey, maybe this is mine. So if you ever need someone to turn to, well, you're in luck, because I'm going to be right here. For as long as you let me. Morgana then stares at Merlin, completely stunned. No one has ever said anything so supportive, so kind to her. And without any warning, she launches herself forward and wraps her arms around him and kisses him hard on the lips. And Merlin's eyes widen in absolute horror. This was not the desired effect. And Merlin grabs her shoulders, ready to push her away when... Merlin? Startled, Merlin shoves Morgana against the counter and she yelps in pain. And he whirls around to face Arthur and Gwen, who have just entered the kitchen, slack-jawed. Terrific. This must look wonderful. Sire, I was... The four of them then stare at each other. Arthur, Morgana says, surprised. And... Arthur's friend. What is going on here? Arthur asks. But a flustered Merlin cannot bring himself to look at Morgana, and he's just too thrown off to form an explanation. You should go, Gwen says to Morgana. But I... Now! Morgana looks to Merlin, hoping he'll back her up, but Merlin does not look back. Confused, Morgana heads down the hall to fetch her son. Merlin, Arthur and Gwen stare at each other in a painful silence. How's Gwen? Merlin says. Gwen is safe. You, however, have a lot of explaining to do. Merlin's hopes of changing the subject are dashed, and Morgana then returns with Galahad. Thank you for having us, she says to Merlin. Good night. They then go to the door, and Galahad gives them all a strange look before leaving. And Morgana's eyes are on Merlin until she shuts the door behind her. What the hell was that? It wasn't what it looked like. Well, then what could it possibly have been? I don't know what happened. We were talking and then we were... obviously not talking. What were you saying? Well,
We bounced around from the dress to wine to Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, God rest his soul, to hearing voices, right up until I said I would try to be there for her, and then she just attacked me.
She attacked you. You know, that used to mean something completely different in reference to Morgana.
Merlin, what were you thinking? When Morgana remembers, what do you think she'll do?
A sudden thought then occurs to Arthur.
Wait, you said you'd be there for her.
But Merlin just looks at him in response.
First thing tomorrow, Gwen begins to say, you must tell Morgana you can't get into a relationship with her.
Wait, no, he can't tell her that.
He can't?
I can. I'm going to do it right now. He then starts for the door, but Arthur quickly blocks his path.
Wait, you just said you'd be there for her. If you go and tell her, sorry, I changed my mind, doesn't that undo what we're trying to accomplish?
Are you completely mad? I killed her, and she has tried to kill me more times than I can remember. And you don't want me to tell her the point-blank truth that I am not and will not ever be interested in her. But we can't throw away all our attempts to reach out to her, just like...
Suddenly, the lights in Merlin's flat start to flicker.
Merlin, would you leave the lights alone?
It's not me.
We then see in Morgana's flat, Galahad using the sink, and it sputters before shutting off altogether. And inside Mordred's lavish chambers, he lies on his mammoth bed gazing at the ceiling vacantly, and the lights flicker, and he glances up detached but curious. Then, Elaine's chambers go dark while Morgoth and Elaine hover over the crystal table. And then we see into an operation room of a hospital, and just as the doctors are performing a surgery, the lights go out. The lights of Elizabeth Tower then shut off, and then the London Eye. In the streets, drivers lose control of their cars as vehicles just die, and we see several gruesome collisions, tyres screeching, glass flying. We then see that all of London has lost power. And then we see the earth glowing from electricity. And in seconds it goes completely dark. All the power on earth has been lost. We then see as Merlin uses magic to light the candles in his living room. And he, Arthur and Gwen all go to the window and look outside. And they see nothing but pitch black. Maybe this is the darkness Morgana was talking about.
What is happening?
Gwen says.
I have no idea.
The sempiternal shadow shall fall, Merlin whispers to himself. As black as the deeds of men.
What was that?
Arthur, I think I know what my prophecy was about.